Hello friends, my name is JJ, and today we are going to do another Canadian politics video. Try to contain your excitement. So Canada is set to have a big national election in October of 2019, in which Prime Minister Justin Trudeau will be fighting to win a second term. Once we get a little bit closer to the vote, I will make a whole video about that, just like I did in 2015 when Trudeau was first elected to power. But in the meantime, I thought it would be fun to just do a sort of generalized Canadian political news update, talking about some of the other things going on in Canadian politics at the moment. You can think of this as some foreshadowing as we get closer to October. Now, in my opinion, one of the biggest developments in Canadian politics over the last few months is how fashionable it has suddenly become to hate on Justin Trudeau, particularly for journalists to hate on him. There was a time not too long ago when a lot of people would have argued that Justin Trudeau got nothing but positive press, but these days there's really a lot less of that. Much of what you read about him in the Canadian papers these days posits him as this very weak and embattled leader struggling to save his political career. Even among progressive journalists, there is a lot less interest in framing Justin Trudeau as this kind of hopeful or aspirational political leader, as opposed to just one more cynical politician. Now, there are a few routes to this. One is the ongoing aftermath of the SNC-Lavalin scandal, which I made a whole other video about. The Lavalin scandal is quite complicated, and I'm not really even convinced that most Canadians really understand it. In a broad sense, it involves the allegation that Justin Trudeau improperly meddled in the judicial system in order to protect a large corporation from facing criminal prosecution. The press has been really obsessed with this story over the last few months, and I would say their coverage unanimously frames Trudeau as the villain. Even if you haven't been following the story that closely, I think it would be very easy to get the impression that Justin Trudeau has done something very bad, just because a lot of credible people are constantly saying so. The Conservative Party has certainly moved very swiftly to weaponize the scandal. Check out this clever ad they made.
His administration continues to be rocked by chaos and controversy. The fallout continues over the firing of his Attorney General and the resignations of his top advisors. He's engaging in a cover-up after he shut down two separate investigations into his scandals. Questions are now being raised about his competence and judgment. In response, he's again lashing out and threatening lawsuits against his critics. Justin Trudeau, he's not who you thought he was. He's not as advertised.
Even though a case can be made that a lot of these allegations are being very sensationalized, it is very hard to argue that Justin Trudeau has done a particularly good job defending himself from them. His explanations for his behavior have changed a lot from day to day, and his people have done a very bad job of countering the criticism from the two female cabinet ministers who lost their jobs as a result of the scandal. These women are very sympathetic characters, and the media has been quite actively taking their side. More recently, Trudeau has also received a lot of bad press over the so-called Mark Norman scandal. This is an even more complicated scandal. I am not convinced that any Canadian even understands at all. The Conservative Party tried to make an ad about it too. It is only 90 seconds long, but I challenge you to follow along for more than 10 seconds without getting lost.
You've probably heard about the Mark Norman trial. This is a serious case of political interference in a criminal case. Let's unpack things. In 2015, the Navy's only remaining supply vessel caught fire. That same year, Stephen Harper's government, recognizing the urgency, worked quickly to get a new supply ship running as soon as possible. In 2015, the Trudeau Liberals take office. They want to delay and possibly restart the bidding process. When information about Trudeau's decision to delay the contract eventually leaked, the weight of intense public pressure forced the Liberal government to reverse their decision. In 2017, Vice Admiral Mark Norman was removed from his job, and Justin Trudeau announced that Mark Norman would inevitably end up in court. In 2018, charges were laid, and Mark Norman would spend the next 2 years embattled in court. His reputation, his finances, and his career were badly damaged. Mark Norman maintains his innocence throughout. Meanwhile, the supply ship the Liberals planned to shut down was delivered on time and under budget. Throughout this entire time, Justin Trudeau withholds documents critical to Mark Norman's defense. Then, in 2019, Liberal MP Andrew Leslie announces he won't be seeking re-election, and he tells the media that he's willing to testify on behalf of Mark Norman. Within days, Mark Norman's charges are suddenly dropped. In the House of Commons, the Conservatives fight to get Trudeau and his government to admit to wrongdoing. But before the motion passes, Trudeau slinks out of the room. The Mark Norman case perfectly illustrates why we need a justice system that is free from political interference and from political pressure.
Does it though? But in any case, this thing has been in the headlines a lot lately. Basically, the second the Lavalin thing started to die down, the Mark Norman thing began to rise. Now, on the one hand, this idea that Justin Trudeau has lost the press seems like a really big deal and a very damning indictment of his administration. However, I would argue this idea that the Canadian press was ever fully in the tank for him was always a bit exaggerated. I think it was always the international press that was most in love with Trudeau. We're talking about like the New York Times and Rolling Stone and The Guardian and Vogue. When we think of these very gushy, superficial profiles of Justin Trudeau, we're usually thinking of something that was written in Britain or America. This is because a lot of Britons and Americans tend to have a very superficial understanding of Canada. A lot of them just always portray Canada as being like this superior society to the US. And certainly after Donald Trump was elected, Justin Trudeau started to receive a lot of favorable coverage, presenting him as like one of the best world leaders on earth. But here in Canada, I would argue there has always been a great deal more skepticism of Trudeau, even among progressive journalists. There has always been a sizable chunk on all sides who have long thought of Justin Trudeau as just this kind of spoiled rich kid who sort of stumbled his way into politics and doesn't really know what he's doing. And even if he did enjoy a sort of honeymoon with the press right after he was elected, by this point, a lot of the scandals have now really taken the luster off of his shine. I was talking with a friend about this the other day, and she said, you know, the media gave him a chance, but now they're clearly very embarrassed that they did. In any case, Trudeau is down in the polls right now, and I'm sure a lot of people in his Liberal Party would say that's because of all the bad press, but Trudeau's critics, of course, would blame it on the scandals that caused the bad press. So, you are wondering, is Trudeau doomed? Well, in addition to the scandals, something that a lot of people would cite as evidence of the tide turning against him would be the recent results of some local elections. You ever notice how foreign political leaders are always portrayed as embattled once they start losing local elections? When Trudeau came to power back in 2015, Canada's provincial governments looked like this. Basically, Liberals everywhere. Circa 2019, however, the map now looks like this. The last big domino to fall was Alberta, which elected the Conservatives to power in a big landslide election last month. That cemented a big wall of Conservative opposition in all of Canada's biggest provinces, as depicted on this cover of Maclean's magazine. If you ever want to know the conventional wisdom of the Canadian political press, by the way, just check out the cover of Maclean's magazine. It's basically like the Bible of mainstream Canadian political narratives. Now, the Canadian national government is very strong, so it remains to be seen if any of these conservative provincial governments can actually hurt Trudeau in any way. Trudeau has been trying to impose a national carbon tax on the country, for instance, and all of the provincial prime ministers are opposed to this, but I think the Canadian Supreme Court will ultimately side with Trudeau on this one. But on the other hand, you have to figure that all of these conservative provincial governments will play a role in changing how a lot of Canadians think of the National Conservative Party. Support for these governments might help foster more goodwill for the conservative brand more generally, particularly if they're seen as governing well. And of course, the conservative provincial governments will just blame Trudeau for everything that's going wrong, so maybe after a while that will start to seep in too. It is interesting that the head of the National Conservatives, Andrew Scheer, continues to be such a forgettable presence, however. There's a sense that he is benefiting from an increasingly favorable political situation, but he isn't really leading it. This is important because, you know, at the end of the day, you're not just voting against someone, you're voting for someone too. And as much as Trudeau's numbers may be slipping, when the moment of truth comes, are Canadians going to be willing to trust this guy with the prime ministership instead? A man who I would wager a huge chunk of this country still barely knows. But anyway, that is enough talk about Trudeau's critics to the right. Let us now talk about Trudeau's critics to the left. Well, the New Democratic Party of Mr. Jagmeet Singh continues to disappoint. The NDP vote has continued to decline in a number of special elections to the National Parliament that have been held since Jagmeet Singh took control of the party in 2017. They in fact lost two seats they already held since he's been in charge. A lot of people would say that this does not bode well for the NDP's performance in the October election. This in turn makes Justin Trudeau's re-election more likely, because a strong NDP is usually considered like a precondition for a conservative victory due to the crazy three-party game theory that governs Canadian elections. In the wake of the NDP's poor performance, the press has really taken to hyping the Canadian Green Party as the next big thing in Canadian left-wing politics, but this is nothing new. In fact, as long as I have been following Canadian politics, which has got to be close to 20 years now, I have been reading articles in the Canadian press about how the Green Party is going to make a big breakthrough, any day now. In fairness to the Green Party, they do have a bit more hard evidence of growing success this time around, though. Just a few years ago, no Green Party people had ever been elected to anything in Canadian politics anywhere. But today, there are 15 Green Party people in the provincial parliaments, and 2 Green Party people in the national parliament. Now, this is still a very infinitesimally small number, given we are talking about 17 out of literally hundreds of seats. But, you know, it's more than zero, right? People even thought they had a plausible shot at winning power in Canada's smallest province, Prince Edward Island, last month, but they did not. Now, I have a hard time talking objectively about the Green Party because I just really, really dislike them. I would say they are my absolute least favorite party in Canada, in fact. I just view them as such a media creation, you know, something that has gotten so much positive press over the last 20 years for doing so little. And it mostly just seems justified by a kind of, hey, wouldn't it be cool if Canada had another party? You know, kind of fantasizing as opposed to anything more justifiable. The other thing I would say is I think the Canadian press's deep fascination with the Green Party and constant cheerleading for them to make some sort of breakthrough has resulted in a real lack of accountability for what the Green Party actually is and what it believes. As I wrote in a recent piece for the Washington Post, the Green Party is kind of a receptacle for Canada's political runoff. People that don't like the mainstream parties vote Green, and these tend to be people that often have a sort of conspiratorial or flaky worldview. Despite the name, I really don't think it is even a very serious environmentalist party. It's just a party that is sort of paranoid about climate change in the same way that it is paranoid about a lot of things. For instance, I think it is pretty clear at this point that the Green Party has a pretty big problem with anti-Semitism within its ranks. It has had a number of openly anti-Semitic candidates over the years, including a very active Holocaust denier who ran for the party 3 times and was recently convicted in Germany. The newest Green Party member of the National Parliament, Paul Manley, is a guy that was kicked out of the NDP, allegedly because his anti-Israel views were too extreme. And the NDP is already considered the most anti-Israel of Canada's 3 main parties, so that should tell you something. But you know, this sort of stuff doesn't often get talked about. Instead, it is the Conservative Party that is actively being framed as being too cozy with bigots and white nationalists. I know this is a sort of stereotypically Fox News sort of thing to say, but I do think the media has a considerable blind spot when it comes to policing bigotry on the left as actively as they police bigotry on the right. Anyway, rant over. I will give you a more in-depth report in a few months once we get a bit closer to the election. If you enjoyed this video, do not forget to like and subscribe, and I will see you all next week.